Hello everyone, welcome to the Indian Deep Learning Initiative talk session. I'm Arpita and today I'll be giving an introductory talk on game theory and mechanism design. Just to give a brief intro about myself, I am a Google PhD fellow at Computer Science and Automation Department at Indian Institute of Science. My PhD advisors are Professor Y. Narahari and Professor Siddharth Burman. I worked as a research engineer at Center India for 2 years. I completed my master's from Computer Science Department, Indian Institute of Science, and BTech from Institute of Engineering and Management. My broad areas of interest include multi-agent learning systems, game theory and mechanism design, and computational social choice theory. Here's a brief outline of my talk. I'll start off by describing the basic concepts in game theory. Then we'll look at the problem of mechanism design. After that, I'll describe cooperative game theory, which involves situations where participants are allowed to collude. After that, we'll look at strategic agents in learning that encompass problems where one needs to learn unknown stochastic parameters, as well as design mechanisms to elicit true values from strategic agents. I'll conclude by outlining some real-world applications of game theory and mechanism design. So please feel free to give your questions. I mean, you can write your questions. I'll take the questions at the end of the session. So to start off, what is game theory? It is a mathematical framework for rigorous study of conflict and cooperation among rational and intelligent agents. Now, what is a rational agent? An agent would always choose an action that maximizes his or her expected utility. That is a rational agent. And what is an utility? Utility in some sense can be thought of as a payoff. Basically, it is the preferences of the players expressed in terms of real numbers. Informally, the term intelligent is used in its dictionary sense. More formally, we assume that the agents are competent enough to make any inferences about the game that a game theorist can make. They can also carry out the required computations involved in determining a best response strategy. Now, let us look at an example of a game and how to analyze it. Prisoner's Dilemma. So this is one of the most extensively studied problems in game theory, with many interesting interpretations in a wide variety of situations. The problem is as follows. There are two individuals who are arrested for a robbery, and it is also witnessed by several people. The police suspects that they were guilty for a similar crime earlier, but were never caught. The prisoners are in separate prisons, and interrogation happens separately. Now, the police tells each prisoner that if you are the only one to confess, you'll get a light sentence of 1 year. You'll be sentenced to 10 years in jail. If both of you confess, both of you would be sentenced for 5 years. And if neither of you confess, then each of you would get 3 years in jail. The police also informs each prisoner that the same has been told to the other prisoner. The last point is termed as common knowledge. Let us now formally describe this problem. So the way to do so is by using the so-called utility matrix. Let us call the two prisoners Bunty and Bubbly. Each of them have two possible actions, either to confess or to not to confess. The cells in the matrix are read as follows. For example, the first cell represents the jail time when Bunty and Bubbly both confesses. Likewise, cell 2 says that if Bunty confesses and Bubbly does not, then Bunty goes to jail for 1 year only, while Bubbly has to languish in jail for 10 years. In other words, each cell represents the outcome of actions taken by both the players. Now, in general, a game consists of a triple. So in this game, what do you think Bunty and Bubbly should do? At a first glance, it seems that not confessing is the best action for both of them, since it results in 3 years of jail time for each. But is it so? Okay, so also remember that they are not allowed to communicate. Okay, let us analyze what is the best action for Bunty if Bubbly chooses to confess. It is clear that Bunty gets 5 years of jail time by confessing, while he gets 10 years by not confessing. So Bunty's best action here would be to confess. I think everybody agrees with me, right? Now let's look at what happens to Bunty's decision if Bubbly chooses not to confess instead. In this case as well, Bunty is better off confessing. Thus, irrespective of what Bubbly does, Bunty's best action is to actually confess. Similarly, Bubbly's best action is to confess if Bunty chooses to confess, and Bubbly's best action is to confess when Bunty chooses not to confess. Thus, Bubbly's best action is always to confess, irrespective of what Bunty chooses to do. Thus, this strategy profile, where both Bunty chooses to confess, results in is called a Nash equilibrium. So, more formally, a Nash equilibrium is a strategy profile in which player gains anything by changing their own strategy. That is, by deviating from a Nash equilibrium strategy, a player will not be better off given that the other players stick to their Nash equilibrium strategies. It is one of the most heavily discussed and debated topics in game theory. It captures a stable, self-enforcing agreement among players. In other words, this is the action profile that a social planner would recommend to all the players and ensure that no one would deviate from their recommended action. The question now is there always a single Nash equilibrium? To answer this, let us consider another game. There are two players, Alice and Bob. Each of them would either choose to work on a deep learning project or a website designing project. Each project requires two participants. Alice prefers the deep learning project over the website designing, while it is the other way around for Bob. Now let us again analyze this game to figure out what should Alice and Bob do. We should use the same methodology as the prisoner's dilemma. If Bob chooses deep learning, then Alice is better off choosing deep learning. And if Bob chooses website designing, then Alice is better off choosing website designing as well. An analogous argument applies to Bob's decisions. This tells us that there are in fact two possible Nash equilibria. You can eyeball and see that no one is better off by unilaterally deviating from their Nash equilibrium strategies. So now the question is, does there exist any other Nash equilibrium in this game? And the answer is yes. One can compute a probability distribution over the action space of the players, and this results in yet another Nash equilibria where Alice chooses deep learning with 2/3 probability and website designing with 1/3 probability. Whereas Bob chooses deep learning with 1/3 probability and website designing with 2/3 probability. This is also called a mixed strategy Nash equilibrium. More formally, compared to all possible distributions, the utility is the greatest using this particular mixed strategy profile. So a mixed strategy of a player is a probability distribution over all the actions. That is, let's say sigma I is the mixed strategy. So it assigns to each pure strategy a probability such that the summation of that is equal to 1. Now, given a game, a mixed strategy profile is called a mixed strategy Nash equilibrium if the utility with this particular strategy profile is always better off for all the agents. Now, the important question is, does Nash equilibrium always exist? And the answer is given by Nash theorem, which says that every finite strategic form game has at least one mixed strategy Nash equilibrium. And the next question is there an efficient algorithm for computing a mixed Nash equilibrium? And there is a seminal result by Daskalakis et al., which shows that finding mixed strategy Nash equilibrium is PPAD complete. There's some other type of equilibrium. Informally, strongly dominant strategy equilibrium states that no matter what the other players do, this player will get a strictly higher payoff by choosing an action AI over any of his other actions BI. In the context of prisoner's dilemma, we see that no matter what Bubbly does, Bunty gets a strictly higher payoff by choosing to confess over not confessing. The same holds for Bubbly. Thus, both of them confessing is a strongly dominant strategy equilibrium. Now, let us modify this prisoner's dilemma problem to show another type of equilibrium, which is known as weakly dominant strategy equilibrium. So this states that no matter what the other players do, this player will get a payoff by choosing an action AI that is at least as high as choosing any other action BI. However, there exists at least one strategy profile of the other players for which player I is strictly better off by choosing action AI. As an example, let us look at this modified prisoner's dilemma problem such that if one confesses and the other does not, then the one confessing gets 3 years in jail and the others get 10 years in jail. So previously we had for confessing 1 year in jail and for not confessing 10 years. Now we are modifying it to 3 years. Now in this setting, both confessing is a weakly dominant strategy equilibrium. I think this is easy to see, right? Okay, so next we'll look at another equilibrium, which is the weakest notion of dominant strategy equilibrium. So this is called very weakly dominant strategy equilibrium. This says that that no player is worse off by choosing AI over any other strategies. For example, let's further modify the prisoner's dilemma problem such that for Bubbly, no action is strictly better than the other for all possible actions of Bunty. So there is no weakly dominant strategy equilibrium, but there is a very weakly dominant strategy equilibrium, which is given by both confessing. So the question is, does always exist a dominant strategy equilibrium? And the answer is no, because if we recall the project coordination game, it is evident that there is no dominant strategy equilibria for the given utility matrix. So there exist other categories of games like repeated games, dynamic games, stochastic games, network games, Stackelberg games, and differential games. So till now, whatever games we looked at, those are static matrix games for two players only. But with while modeling real problems into games, things might not be that simple, and we might have to model it as a dynamic game or repeated game or maybe a multi-level game also. So analyzing these games show how agents can rationally form beliefs over what other agents do, and hence how agents should act. This is also useful for taking a profitable action as well as predicting behavior of others. Okay, so let's now ask a different question. How would you create a game to achieve a desired objective? And the answer is mechanism design. So mechanism design is also called reverse engineering of games. It is an art of designing the rules of a game to achieve a specified outcome. In particular, game theory and mechanism design has emerged as an important tool to model, analyze, and solve decentralized design problems in engineering involving multiple autonomous agents that interact strategically in a rational and intelligent way. For example, consider a sponsored search auction. Let's say you search for green tea on Google. You will find certain results tagged as sponsored. How does one decide which product to display and their ordering? So the answer is given by this sponsored search auction. So one way to do that is to assume that there is a separate auction for every query, and then positions are assigned to ads in the order of their bids. The payment is typically a function of the bids of the advertisers. Now let us look at a simple setting where we only have one ad slot and there are n competing advertisers. The question is which ad to show and what should the advertiser pay. Now, solving this requires a mechanism which comprises of an allocation rule and a payment rule. One such mechanism is the VCG mechanism. The allocation vector for a VCG mechanism is a binary vector of width n. Say the bit I is set to 1 if ad I is chosen, in which case the other bits are set to 0. Now let us denote this by EI. So this vector where we denote that who has received the slot and who has not is denoted by EI. Now the valuation V for all advertisers whose ads have not been selected is 0. Otherwise, it is equal to what the chosen advertiser's value for the slot. Now the allocation rule is to choose an EI that maximizes the sum of valuations. For the one ad slot problem, this rule chooses the advertisement for which the maximum bid is placed. So if you look at the allocation, you can see that the one who has bid maximum, for that person, the summation of VI is equal to the value of the maximum bid. So the ad slot is given to the advertiser who has bid the maximum. Now let us look at what the payment rule is. So the payment rule is given by the following expression. The first term says that it is the sum of the gross valuation of all the advertisers except I, and the second term is the sum of the gross valuations of all the advertisers assuming that advertiser is absent in the system overall. So the difference between the first and second term is, in first term we assume that advertiser I, who has been allocated the slot, is present in the system, and we take the summation of over all the other agents. And in the second term, we assume that the advertiser is not present in the system, and then we take the summation of all advertisers in that system. Right? So this is the payment rule. Now, essentially, for this single slot ad problem, this boils down to the chosen advertiser paying the valuation of the second highest bid and all other advertisers paying a value of 0. Now, essentially, we would like a mechanism to satisfy some desirable properties like allocatively efficient, that is, allocations should maximize the sum of values obtained by all the players. We also want the mechanism to be visually rational, that is, player do not lose anything by participating in the game as voluntary participation. So the utilities are always greater than equal to 0, because if they do not participate, maybe the utility is 0, and if they participate, the values should be greater than equal to 0. There's one more desirable property which is known as dominant strategy incentive compatibility. This is also known as strategy proofness. That is, we do not want the agents to lie about their bids and cheat the system. So basically, you want to design a mechanism to ensure that it is strategy proof. Also, we want the mechanism to be non-dictator, to have no dictator in it. This is called non-dictatorship. That is, there is no agent for whom all outcomes turn out to be the favored outcomes. So this ends the mechanism design concepts. And now we'll look at more class of category of game theory, which is known as cooperative game theory. So till now, we have looked at the examples which are non-cooperative in nature. That is, the agents are not allowed to communicate themselves. For example, in prisoner's dilemma, the prisoners were not allowed to communicate among themselves. Even for this sponsor search, we assume that these advertisers are not communicating with each other, and their bids are independently given in a sealed manner. But in real world, it is not always the case. So in most of the scenarios, the assumption of non-cooperation may not be natural. So we have to assume that there's a cooperation or coalition going on among the players in the system. So this gives rise to this particular section, and this is called cooperative game theory. So there's an incentive to cooperate, and collusion, binding contracts, side payments, these are some of the things to incentivize cooperation. Players can also form a group and they can cheat the system to get a better payoff. So whatever mechanisms or whatever analysis we do, we have to keep in mind that it should be always Pareto optimal. That is, given any group of people, they should not be able to get a better utility than what the social planner says. So the questions of interest are this. What are the conditions for forming the stable coalitions? When will a single coalition or a grand coalition be formed? What is a fair distribution of payoffs among these players? Now, to answer this, we have a solution concept called Shapley value. So this famous Shapley's theorem, which says that there is this unique expression that satisfies or some of the desirable properties of a cooperative game. To understand this expression, let me give an example of a project contract. Now, what is a project contract game? So we assume that there's a single project which is worth, let's say, rupees 300, and there's one contractor, we call it C. There are two laborers, we call them A and B. Now, the game is as follows. The contractor alone cannot finish the project without the laborers. The laborers again cannot get the project contract even without the contractor. Now, if the contractor gets the project, it can be completed with the help of at least one laborer. Now, let us try to put these statements in a formal notation. So what we say is the valuation of an empty set 0. The valuation of A, which is a single laborer, is 0. Valuation of B is 0. Valuation of C is 0 because the contractor alone cannot finish the project without the laborers. And the valuation of AB together is also 0 because both laborer cannot finish the project without the contractor. Now, what is the valuation of A and C together? So the contractor can finish the work with the help of at least one laborer. So in the presence of A, B, and also both, the valuation is always 300, right? So now the question is, how do we split the cost among the contractor and the two laborers? Now, is a split of 100, 100, and 100 a good enough split? So this split may look fair, but let us try to analyze the game and see what Shapley value tells us. Now again, let's recall. The Shapley value expression is given by this particular expression. So what this expression say is this, that let us say you want to compute the Shapley value for an agent I. We take all the subsets of the players where I is absent, and then we try to find out the marginal contribution of I in the subset. And we take an average over all the possible subsets. Right? So this is informally the meaning of this expression. Now let's see how do we compute Shapley value in this particular case. So phi A of V. So we want to first find the valuation for, first find the payment for agent A, which is a laborer. So we just put in the values as we have seen. We can put the valuations of 0 or 300 as it is, and this turns out to be 50. Similarly, let us try to see that what is the valuation or the payment to laborer B. This also turns out to be 50. You can actually, it's a good exercise. You can try to like solve this problem and see that the computations are correct or not. Okay, and for contractor, if we want to compute the Shapley value, this gives 200. So the Shapley value says that the optimal split is 50, 50, and 200. Now, similarly, we can use some other solution concepts in cooperative game theory. There are statements like, there are solution concepts like stable sets, core, kernel, nucleolus, the Gately point. All these solution concepts satisfy some specific properties and are used in cooperative game theory. Now, till now, we have looked at non-cooperative game theory, mechanism design, and cooperative game theory. Now, we'll go to another section, which we call strategic agents in learning. So, basically, I'll be talking about multi-arm banded problem. So multi-arm banded problem is an intersection of reinforcement learning and game theory. So the problem is like this. There are multiple arms or slot machines. Each arm, when pulled, gives a reward, and we assume that the reward is drawn from some unknown distribution. So the distributions are unknown, or maybe the distribution is known but the parameters are unknown. Informally, we say that the distributions are unknown, and there's a limit on the number of pulls that are available for us to get reward. Now the goal is to maximize the total expected reward that is accumulated over the limited number of pulls. Now, this problem leads to an exploration versus exploitation trade-off. So what do we mean by that? Now, let us suppose you have some n pulls, and then what you can do is you can keep pulling all the arms as many times as possible and get a good sample estimate of the average reward that you get from each of the slots. Once you have an idea of which slot machine is the best slot machine, you can keep pulling that slot machine for the rest of the times. Now the problem is, the more you explore, the more you are losing out exploring the arms. So let's say the best slot machine is given by the first one. Let's say the red slot machine gives you the best one, but because it is unknown to you, you keep pulling all the other arms, the blue arms also, to accumulate some rewards. And finally, when you are when you are satisfied with the fact that the red slot machine gives you the best, you keep pulling the red one. But more you explore, more you lose. More you lose by pulling the non-optimal arms. What if you reduce the exploration time? So let's say you have pulled red, blue, and green once, and because the arms are assumed to give stochastic rewards, it might happen that in that particular draw, blue gave most of the maximum reward. Now, if you quickly come to the conclusion that blue is the best slot machine, and you keep pulling blue slot machine for the rest of the time, you actually lose a lot of reward because you are pulling the non-optimal arm for the rest of the time. So the trade-off is you have to accumulate enough samples so that you are quite confident about which one is the best one, and also you don't want to lose a lot on a lot of turns by just exploring. So because your number of pulls are limited, so this leads to an exploration versus exploitation trade-off. Now, why is this this particular setting useful? So this is mainly useful in solving any sequential decision problem where there are parameters which are unknown and you have to learn those parameters. For example, let's say pay-per-click advertisements. So in pay-per-click advertisement, each advertiser pays a value only when a user clicks the ad. So unlike the mechanism design problem where we assume that there is an auction and players are asked to give their bids, here we are assuming a different kind of payment where we say that, let's say there is a fixed payment for every advertiser. It's just that the advertiser pays only when they get a click from a user. Now, each ad here is an arm, and the click probability are the stochastic rewards that are to be learned. So if the search engine learns that an ad, let's say XY, has the maximum click probability, then it will keep putting that particular ad in this one ad slot problem. Right, so this can be modeled as a multi-arm banded problem. Now, what happens when we consider the slot machines to be strategic? Okay, so let's now look at another scenario. Let's say each arm has a stochastic reward, which is the click probabilities. And they also bid a value. So now we do not consider all advertisers paying a uniform value. We assume that the advertisers bid initially a value for the slot that he is willing to pay when a user clicks the ad. So now the payment received by the search engine is a function of the click probability of that particular ad and the declared bid of the advertiser. So as you can see that there are two parameters here. The click probabilities of the ads are values which are unknown to the search engine and also to the advertiser. So no one knows what these click probabilities are. So you need to actually put these ads on some platform, see whether a user clicks it or not, and then you'll be able to learn what is the probability that this particular ad gets clicked. So there is no other way to declare this click probabilities beforehand. And again, there is one more parameter, which is the bid of the advertisers. And the advertisers being strategic, they might try to the system by bidding a very low value. But then you want to design a mechanism, which is basically an allocation rule and a payment rule that ensures truthful elicitation of bids, that is the strategy proofness. And you also want to maximize the total payment that is received from your advertisers within a limited number of trials. So this particular problem can be modeled as multi-arm banded mechanism design problem. This is also known as MAB problem, multi-unbounded mechanism design problem. So this setting can also be used to solve other real world applications. For example, let's look at resource allocation problem. So in resource allocation problem, we have to find a fair split of resource among all the agents. Now, what can be a strategic parameter in this particular scenario? So each of this agent can be asked to give a valuation for the split. So let us assume that the resource is a cake and everyone has a valuation for the valuation for different pieces of the cake. So some person may like the topping of the cake, some person might be wanting some other parts of the cake. So everybody has their own valuation, and also some may like, some may not prefer sweet that much. So the valuations might differ among the agents. Now the thing is, if you ask these agents to report their true values, and then you try to find out a fair split among them with some concept of fairness, maybe then it becomes it becomes like finding a feasible solution, right? But if the problem is this, that they might cheat and they might not give their proper valuation, like they might say, I want the entire cake. So you might not want people to declare a untruthful value if they are only happy with one piece of the cake. They should not say that I want the entire cake. So you have to design a mechanism accordingly. So in resource allocation, you might want, and so there also might be learning parameters that are unknown to the system, and the system might want to learn and as well as see that there is strategy proofness in the system. Similarly, there is this procurement auction, where we have to design auctions that maximize social utilities. There is crowdsourcing, where you design a mechanism to complete as many tasks as possible with maximum quality. So in crowdsourcing scenario, let us assume that you have crowd workers, and each crowd worker has a certain probability of finishing a task. And let's call it the quality of the crowd worker. Now, this quality is something that is not known by the crowd workers or the system in advance, because the crowd workers have never. So let's say when the system starts, when this online crowdsourcing platform starts, it has a number of crowd workers registered, but they all are new. So they have no idea how good these crowd workers will perform on a given task. So the system would try to learn the quality of each of these crowd workers. So this leads to a multi-unbounded setting. Now, this might as well happen that at some point of time, the system wants the crowd workers to bid what value they want in when they complete a task. So it is basically saying that you create an auction for each of the tasks. So you say that, okay, I'll give this task to someone who is bidding less. But again, we have to also see that that crowd worker should have a good quality also. So again, your allocation and payment mechanism would both depend on the quality of a crowd worker and the bid that the crowd worker pays, bid that the crowd worker demands. Now, this is similar to online advertising, but the results are not straightly carried forward, because this is a reverse payment case. So here, you're not getting a payment. You have to give the payment to the crowd workers. So that involves different mechanism. But this is an important problem where both multi-agent learning or multi-unbounded, as organism design is involved. And there has been a lot of papers and work around crowdsourcing. Also, in online education platforms, of designing incentives to improve the participation level of students and instructors. In this kind of problems also, you have learning parameters as well as mechanism design parameters. There's a work on the social network analysis, where you have to discover influential nodes, you have to provide incentives to ensure that there's maximum spread of information over a network. And this kind of problems also involve a lot of game theory, mechanism design, as well as learning problem, where you might have to learn the probability of an information that is spreading from one node to another. You might have to incentivize each of these nodes in a way that they actually spread the news, and that is their best response to spread the news as soon as possible. There can be referral network analysis in this social network problems, mechanism design, as well as learning problem. Yes, so having said that, there are like lot of real world applications and opportunities to put into mechanism design and learning together into one complete framework, and it has a lot of scope to give new results in different domains. I mean, theoretical results in this real. So I would like to end this session with some useful links that I have put, and the book that I have followed for preparing this particular talk is called Game Theory and Mechanism Design by Professor Weiner Ruhari. And yeah, thank you for your attention. I'd like to take the questions now. Okay, I got a question now. Can you describe some kinds of game theory with AI? So the thing is this, if you look at artificial intelligence problem, so it's mostly like you have a game and you want to find a winning strategy for an agent. So it's like, how do you make a machine learn the winning strategy? This in game theory, you might want to find what is the best strategy for a user, but it's more of a social welfare. So there are other aspects. For example, in game theory, you might also want to find an equilibrium strategy. That is, you might want, so there might be a social planner who wants to dictate a strategy to all the agents, and the strategy should be stable and self-enforcing by itself. That is, nobody should get anything by deviating from that strategy. Right? This type of analysis is more a game theory than artificial intelligence. If you want to have a connection, I think when you talk about Maxmin strategies, game theory and artificial intelligence will give you the same solutions. Yeah, so this was to answer Jacob's question on can you describe some connections of game theory with AI. So okay, I think I have another question, which is, can we implement game theory where probability is equal, like rock, paper, scissors? Yes, you can. Actually, this is what we call a mixed strategy Nash equilibrium. So equilibrium here is going to be giving a one-third probability to all the actions, basically. Yeah. So yes, you can use game theory to analyze a rock, paper, scissors game. And there is only one Nash equilibrium actually, which is giving one-third probability to all the actions. Yes, this is a good question. How much of game theory is used in decision theory, where decisions need to be made under incomplete information scenario? So the thing is, some of the examples that I was mentioning, some of the real world applications, there you have seen that it's a decision theory, right? For example, which ad to put in an ad slot, this is a decision theory. So the thing is, suppose you declare that whoever gets an allocation has to pay rupees 1 whenever you get a click, but that might not be suitable for some of the advertisers. So you might want to make it more relaxed by saying the advertisers that, okay, you can bid whatever you want to, but then I'll choose someone who has the maximum expected gain for me. So the expected gain will again involve the probability, click probability, as well as this the bid that they give. So whoever maximizes this click probability multiplied by bid, I might prefer that particular person in that particular slot, right? So yes, I think game theory is used in decision theory in this aspect. Even auctions are kind of a decision theory, right? You have to decide who pays what and what to give them to. So that is also a decision theory problem. Okay, another question. So we can help autonomous systems to do planning and make decisions. Yes, because when I talk about the problem of this crowdsourcing, let's say in online crowdsourcing platforms are also some autonomous platform, right? Because there should be some system that automatically suggests that this is the crowd worker whom you should give the task to. So when you have an underlying game theory, it knows that, okay, this is the particular payment that this crowd worker expects. And if you give this task to the crowd worker, you would gain the maximum. So yes, I think help autonomous systems to do planning and make decisions. Thank you for listening. Thank you for your attention. Feel free to put more questions.